word parable means to lay alongside of. Literally, it means to throw alongside of. He told stories about trading, bargaining, debts owed and debts paid, about buying and redeeming. Stories about judges and courts, about prison and justifying and declaring not guilty. Stories about declaring innocent and testifying and giving witness. Stories about planting seeds, about vineyards, about sheep and goats, about harvest and weeds and wheat, about landowners and laborers. Stories about common, everyday things and events. But we get in trouble with these parables, with these stories of Jesus, when we take these very concrete stories literally, and we try to freeze these dynamic stories and make them static. We try to turn parables into rule books and law books. In today's gospel, Peter asked Jesus, "How often should I forgive my brother and sister?" And Peter probably thought he was being generous. 7 times? And Jesus responded, "Not 7, but 77 times." Some people actually try to calculate that. Where am I with that? We try to squeeze these parables into categories we're familiar with. And so we can remain in control. Conventional ways of thinking are confounded when it comes to the parables. Beginning today and for about a month now, our Gospels will come from the parables of Jesus in Matthew's Gospel. People have really strong reactions to the parable if they really hear them. People get angry. They get scared. They get confused and disoriented by these stories of Jesus. And teachers and preachers spend so much time trying to explain these parables in terms of concepts and categories that we're familiar with. But if you really listen to the parables, it's like they pull a rug out from under us and we don't know what to think. We think that if we follow all the rules, all is well. I'm safe if I'm good. And if I collect good deeds like S&H Green stamps, I will be rewarded at the Redemption Center. But God does not play by these rules. Ask old Joe. Jesus' main teaching was about the kingdom of God, or as Matthew has it, the kingdom of heaven. And most of these parables we'll hear in the next few weeks are the kingdom of, begin rather with Jesus saying, the kingdom of God is like, and then he tells a story. And actually, kingdom might not be the best translation of Jesus' teaching, especially when we come to kingdom of heaven, because we then think about an afterlife or a place where Jesus' kingdom is. Perhaps it would be better to think of the dominion of God or the reign of God, rather than a settled place, a dynamism unfolding rather than something settled and boxed. Rather than the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven being about an afterlife, the kingdom of heaven is about God active in the world in our daily lives right here and right now. And if it is about the future, it's about the future breaking into the present, relativizing everything as it is. That stops and breaks up getting along, going along together. The kingdom is about God breaking into our present and shattering present arrangements. Why? So that new possibilities can be seen. You know, when God shakes up our lives, or when life just shakes us up, we may feel that, you know, God is punishment. People are going around now that Irma and Harvey were because of this or for that. We tend to look for reasons of punishment. But when God shakes us up, God is doing it maybe not so much to punish us, but to get us to look at a wider vision than that narrow vision we've been looking at. Maybe when God shakes up our lives, we can look up and see further than the little mess we're moving around like little rats. Jesus' parables of the kingdom tell us there's another way to be. There is another way to live, and we don't have to work to the next world to do that, but right here and now, in everyday, ordinary thing, God wants us to be open to God's way. God has a vision. So when you hear these parables these next few weeks, if you get mad, that means you really hear them. Why did this man who was hired at last get paid the same as I did, and I've been working all these years in this church? That makes me mad. Unless I'm not no man. Parables disorient for a reason. But don't look to the parables so much for rules. Don't even maybe look to the parables for reassurance and comfort. Actually, the parables are not designed to comfort us, but to change us. Amen? To open us to possibly another way that I didn't see before. So as you listen, if you're offended by Jesus' parables, good, you've been hearing them. Sometimes we don't hear them because we just say, God is nice, and God wouldn't do that. The kingdom of God is God's activity now. God working effectively in our everyday lives. Jesus wants us, his disciples, to see things that the world does not see. People who heard Jesus' stories would know right away what he's talking about. But we're not people back then when Jesus told his story, so we have to do a little work to be able to hear them with fresh ears. Because what we usually do when we hear them, we think we understand, we know what he's talking about, so we don't even investigate. We just affirm what we already know. But let me look at a couple things today and see if that might give us a window into the power of these parables, particularly of today's parable. A slave owed the king 10,000 talents. Now I read single talent, remember 10,000 talents, 1,000 talent was worth more than 15 years of labor salary. Can you imagine that? So 10,000 talents would be 150 to 200,000 years of wages. An outlandish debt. The slave would never, ever be able to pay it. This debt is so huge. You know how you feel when you have these bills over here and you don't even want to open the envelopes, and you know, even though you don't open it, it's still on your consciousness, and you don't feel good until the money comes through and you can pay. You know how that feels, but to be dominated by such a huge debt, the man would never have any peace. He'd always be thinking about how old these folks. So this man begged the king, and the king had pity. Put a finger on pity, I'll go back there later. But before that, I want to look at his fellow slaves' debt was 100 denarii. One denarius was a day's wages. So 100 denarii, though over a half million less than the first debt, is still a big debt, which a slave could not afford to pay. Although small in comparison with the other, it still couldn't be paid. Doesn't that give a broader picture of what's going on here? A king forgave his slave an astronomical debt. Why did he do it? In verse 27, it says, because he had pity. Now stay with me, church. Sometimes these translations don't really capture fully the words. Like when Jesus saw the crowds, he had pity on them, compassion, because they seemed like sheep without a shepherd. Pity, the same word used here, literally means he was moved in his bowels. Okay? There's several places in the King James translation where it comes through very clearly. When Joseph saw his brothers, he, remember Joseph, the story of Joseph we just had? He ran from the room and was crying because he was moved in his bowels. In his gut. Viscerally moved, visceral, where the organs are, in the guts, the bowels, the seat of love and tenderness and affection and heart and caring. Not just the patronizing. I can do this for you. No. What does this parable tell us about God? This king is so moved by this man's humongous need that the king needs to act on this man's behalf. This king is so moved from the depth of his being, from his gut, that he has to do something about this man's situation. And he forgave him and loosed him. God's favor, church, and God's mercy is evoked in direct proportion to our destitution, our lack of inner and outer resources, our need. Moves God to act on our behalf. Our need is what creates God of the Bible is not the same God of the philosophers. The God of the philosopher is the unmoved mover. You heard that? But Rabbi Heschel says the God of the Bible, Old and New Testament, but the God of the Bible is the most moved mover. Oh, hallelujah. Our need is what God sees. And what causes God to respond. Even when we don't know how needy we are. God has, so to speak, to respond to our needs. Jesus didn't teach something that he didn't do. His teaching and acts were both there. So all of his life, Jesus was reaching out to outcasts and needy sinners. Their behavior didn't merit his reaching out, but their need was so great, and that caused God to move. Do you hear that? That our God has to respond to our need. This is the type of God we serve. We usually don't think that we say, let me, you know, save up my good deeds. Let me cover up the wrong I've done. Let me go to church and just tell them how great I am and how great I are rather than how needy I am. You ever go to church, everybody's got this and then, oh, I got this, honey, and then. Well, you don't need God then. You got everything you need. A church word for this is grace. Grace is God's need to respond to our need. Hallelujah. Actually, it's saying the very being of God is self-giving love. In Jesus and the Holy Spirit, God just doesn't remain way up there. God is way up there. But in the Holy Spirit and in Jesus, God comes close and touches us and gets inside us. That's the God we serve. So high you can't get over, so wide and so low. This is the God who has come close to us in Jesus Christ. Not because we are good, but because God is good.
Yes. Yes.
In Jesus, God gives God's very self. The giver is the gift. Now we can get some real attitudes in this. When it comes to God, some of us feel entitled. Well, I deserve this. I've served God all these years. I've worked for this. And then there's the other part. There's a lot of us, more than you think, refuse that because I don't deserve this. We need to let go of both of those attitudes.
Amen.
And just accept the fact that God accepts me.
Amen.
Nothing I can do can make God love me more. Nothing I can do can make God love me less. God loves me. God doesn't love me because I'm so powerful. God loves me because I need thee every hour. Every hour I need thee. Oh, touch me now, my Savior. Hallelujah. Each of us have been given a new opportunity. We woke up today, didn't we? And that wasn't because we're so good, church. We woke up this morning because God loves us. So we need to go beyond bargaining and pleading. We need to go beyond, I'm not worthy. And we need simply to accept that God loves us. And you know what loved people do? They love. They love. So this divine mercy that comes to us needs to be imitated by us. And in fact, if that mercy comes to us and just stays to us, it's going to dry up and die.
Yes.
Unless it passes through us and goes out to other people with forgiveness and acceptance, it's going to die. Actually, Jesus said it earlier in the gospel, "For with the judgment you make, you will be judged. And the measure you give will be the measure you get." Church, God sees all. But the good news, the gospel, the kingdom is that God looked beyond my faults and saw my need, and I'm so grateful. I am so grateful. That's why we don't only speak of grace, we speak of what? Amazing grace. Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. Hallelujah. Don't try to do more so much. Don't try to earn so much. Just praise this amazing grace that came to me and lifted me up when I couldn't lift myself. Hallelujah. For it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my faults and saw my need. Church, therefore, I shall forever lift my eyes to Calvary to view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous the grace that caught my fallen soul. He looked beyond my fault and he saw my need. Hallelujah. Amazing grace shall always be our song of praise. Praise God for God is good. Praise God. Praise God for his grace. Praise God for saving us. And we can do no more than he did. Look beyond each other's faults. And we move to go out and lead. And let the church say amen.
Amen.